Museum of Arts and Design. I am Glenn Adamson, the Nanette Laitman Director here at the museum, and a warm welcome to you all. We're here tonight for a very exciting panel discussion with three young and tremendously skilled and innovative designers, and we're here really to celebrate their creativity. The reason that they have been selected, of course, as you all know, is that they are recipients of the Vilcek Foundation Design Prize, and we're very honored to have Mr. and Mrs. Vilcek, as well as Rick Kinsel from the foundation, with us tonight. We, in fact, honored the Vilcek Foundation for their many contributions, not only to science, but also to the arts and design fields, at our annual gala last November, and I came to know the Vilceks and Rick at that time, and have continued to be extremely impressed with their philanthropic work in this area. And in fact, they're moving more and more into design, and particularly into the intersection between design and art and science and technology. And to me, this is a very inspiring move on their part. You may or may not be aware that the president, President Obama, declared yesterday, 18th of June 2014, as the National Day of Making here in the United States, and held a Maker Fair at the White House. It so happens that we have an exhibition opening up just in about 10 days' time, which is called NYC Makers, and it's the first edition of our biennial, and it is in fact curated by Jake Usna, who's also our head of public programs and has helped to organize tonight. Our show will be a survey of skilled creative makers from across New York City, 100 makers in all, and working in every sort of creative field, fashion, architecture, various forms of design, ceramics, glass, textiles, and of course technology. And it's really at this intersection of the arts more broadly, the arts and sciences more broadly, a field of enterprise that was thought historically to be entirely unified across the whole range from philosophy all the way to the heart of sciences. And it's in a way this kind of cross-disciplinary, lateral, unified thinking that we're here to celebrate tonight, and indeed that the museum is here to celebrate in general. So that's a little foretaste of what's coming up at the museum. I'm first going to introduce our three speakers. Each of them will present their work with images for about 15 or 20 minutes, and then we're going to gather on the stage for a discussion, and then of course your questions and some answers at the end. So let me then introduce my speakers. It should be said that the Vilcek Foundation focuses particularly on immigrants and immigration as a creative and positive force in American culture. And so each of our three designers were born elsewhere. We have Mansour Ourasanah from Togo, Quilian Riano from Colombia, and Neri Oxman from Israel. So I'll just give you a little sense of each of their work. Mansour Ourasanah is a senior designer for Whirlpool's Advanced Studio in Chicago, where his role is to create innovative, user-centered solutions for a new generation of global and hyper-connected consumers, no doubt including all of you. His work focuses on the importance of storytelling in the design of products that address complex emotional and environmental challenges. And you may know him for his most recent project, which is called Lepsis, and it is subtitled The Art of Growing Grasshoppers. So this is a vessel, which I'm sure he'll show you, that can be used to grow insects for food in an effort to promote sustainable meat production and consumption amongst urban populations. So he's here to pitch you all on the idea of grasshoppers for dinner after our event. Then we have Quilian Riano, the founder of Design Agency, that's spelled without vowels. So Design Agency, D-S-G-N-A-G-N-C, just as it sounds, a practice focused on housing and public space design. Quilian seeks to address social issues that negatively affect communities by bringing together transdisciplinary groups and community leaders to create proposals that acknowledge and navigate the complex interactions of social, political, economic, and spatial urban processes. The agency has found great success already, taking on several projects in the United States and in Latin America. Riano's social design efforts include work with the Corona Plaza Engagement Project, La Union Community Project, and Casas de la Esperanza Community Project, which have earned him widespread recognition. Finally, Neri Oxman, joining us from MIT, Neri was raised in Israel, came here to the United States in 2005, and is well known for having coined the phrase material ecology. You may have seen her extraordinary dress design following on some of her work in material ecology in our recent exhibition Out of Hand, which looked at various forms of advanced digital production techniques in art and design. So Oxman is really located right at the leading edge of the intersection between the biological revolution and the design revolution of the 21st century. Her work challenges traditional design principles across a wide range of disciplines, architecture, product design, fashion, as I said, by juxtaposing material properties and environmental constraints to generate breathtaking new forms, as you'll see. She has received many awards and recognitions and honors, and her work is displayed in institutions including MoMA, our friends here in New York City, the Centre Pompidou in Paris, the MFA, Boston, the Smithsonian. And as I said, she teaches at the Media Lab, the great hub of research and innovation at MIT in the area of media arts and sciences, and is the founder and director of the Mediated Matter Design Research Group. So with that, I'm now going to turn you over to our designers, and please join me in welcoming them to the stage.
So my name is Mansour Ourasanah, and I discovered industrial design as a sophomore at the University of Notre Dame. And that was after a brief stint as an engineer. And I can tell you there's nothing scarier than telling your African parents that you don't want to be an engineer anymore. in that case, your plan B better be medicine. So when I told my dad I wanted to be an industrial designer, you know, he was quite blunt. And his response was, you know, this isn't some bullshit artistic career, is it? You know, you better not go and sit on the grass and draw for 3 years. So I was very lucky that the word industrial design didn't have any mention of art, right? The word industrial just sounded so important, so complex, that they just allowed me to do it because even though they had no idea what I did. So what exactly do I do? So that most definitions will tell you that an industrial designer is someone who creates a wide range of items from everyday products, such as mobile phones, household appliances, cars, to larger items such as industrial tools, equipment, and machinery. It's true, but it's not entirely accurate. We also create desire. We create trends. We create experiences. Each one of these products on this page, you know, has been designed, has been conceived and designed by a product designer at some point. And these are often the cornerstone of our lifestyles and the zeitgeist of our generations. But that's not all industrial designers do. Most of us own these products not necessarily out of necessity most time, but mostly because we want them. But there's also a different type of product. Industrial designers are also responsible for products like these, products that, unlike the ones I showed you on the previous slide, solve problems. These are products that are just as beautiful, but they do this one thing beautifully. The one on the left, for instance, is a straw and filter combination that allows you to drink dirty water. The one in the middle is a sensor-based collar that essentially inflates into a helmet during a biking accident. And the third one is a Jawbone app, which I'm sure a lot of people know, which tracks your physical activity every single day. This is the part about design that excited me when I discovered design as a sophomore, and it's the part that I hope inspires a lot more people. So as creatives, you know, we're often faced with this existential I would say struggle, you know, how best to use our skills. And that's because we live in a world full of problems, full of wars, inequalities, and it's only fair that the few of us who can actually make a difference, you know, feel the need to do so. That's why in 2009, I quit my job and decided, you know, to go to Sweden, to the Umeå Institute of Design, to earn my master's. And the point wasn't necessarily for me to earn a master, I could have done that here, but it was to explore my potential as a socially conscious and problem-solving designer. And I needed a sort of getaway to do that. And in Umeå, what I found out in Umeå is that, you know, the first thing I realized is that I needed to be able to dream big as a designer. Sometimes we're often locked into a box and told to design things that need to go to market, even though the world in which we live even though the world in which we live, you know, has people, you know, who dream big. As Johann Guten said, you know, dream no small dreams, for they have no power to move the heart of men. You know, the world in which we live are designed by people who've had the courage to ask, what if? Even in the face of ridicule, in the face of mockery, you know, people like the Wright brothers, you know, who ask, what if men could fly? Or Nelson Mandela, who asked, what if, you know, we were all equal? Okay. Or Steve Jobs, who asked, what if we all had personal computers? And, you know, this young boy, William, you know, Katwamba from Malawi, who asked himself, what if I could create a windmill out of the junk around my house? So what all of these people had in common, I realized, was that despite being, you know, creative geniuses in some, to some extent, they allowed their personal experiences to shape their ideals. And that's what I had to come to terms with in Umeå. And this is what my life looks like, you know, for the first 16 years of my life. At the age of 4, I was diagnosed with kwashiorkor, which is a severe form of malnutrition and protein deficiency. At the age of 5, I went to school that was barely a school with no roof and walls. At the age of 7, I was scavenging, you know, for metals, scraps, and charcoal to sell for pennies. At the age of 8, you know, I was fetching for my own water in little small underwears and no shoes. At the age of 9, I almost died from malaria. And throughout this entire period, you know, I ate insects. So that should tell you that life is different around the world and that you're sort of privileged to be here in certain extent. But don't get me wrong, I had an amazing childhood. It just wasn't fun all the time. And that's because, you know, I grew up in the 10th poorest country of the world, Togo, with very small population and a really small capital. So, but the thing I got out of this experience, you know, knowing that I'm here now, is that I was able to nurture that, you know, as a form of motivation for me to solve some of the most challenging problems, you know, faced by the world today, namely nutrition, health, and education. So I'm here today to ask, you know, what if food production was more sustainable, for instance? Why am I asking that? Because 50% of the world is already being used to produce meat. A half pound of burger, for instance, the amount of energy it takes to create a half pound of burger has the same impact on the planet as a 3,000 pound car driving for about an hour. So what do we do when faced with, you know, such a challenge? The solution isn't necessarily, you know, this isn't necessarily population control. All right, there are about 7 billion of us right now, and there'll be about 9 billion of us in 2050. And based on where we're going, we'll need a second planet. At this rate, we'll need a second planet to be able to feed everybody. So the solution isn't, like I said earlier, isn't necessarily to create, to, you know, initiate population control or to, you know, to produce more meat, but it's instead to look at an alternative to protein production, an alternative that is less demanding on the planet, but it's just as viable nutritionally, an alternative like insects. And why? Because insects, you know, are essentially 70% protein and very little fat. It's a diet enjoyed by 2 billion people around the world, you know, as you saw earlier, I did. And there are about 1,400 species of insects that can be eaten. So what I did in 2012 was to design a prototype, a product that essentially will allow people to grow their own insects at home and turn them into food. It's called Lepsis. And what it is, essentially, is a device that allows you to breed insects using enough feed to create 9 kilograms of insects, as opposed to 1 kilogram of beef, you know, for the same amount of feed. So, since I said earlier, you know, as we know, knowing that the population is going to increase inevitably, this is not necessarily the most viable solution, but it is one solution out of many, and one solution that I hope can inspire a lot more people to create more unconventional solutions to deal with this problem. So what is Lepsis? Lepsis is essentially a unit that comes in 3 sets. You have a nest, a harvester, and a trap. The nest is where the grasshoppers grow. The harvester allows you to collect the insects when they've reached adult edible size. And the trap allows you to lure them from the nest into the harvester. And all these units come together beautifully to create an ecosystem that essentially that is tailored to your lifestyle and to your nutritional demands. When I was a kid, my mom told me that my birth was the happiest and the scariest moment of her life. And at the time, I didn't get it. But over time, I sort of understood that this is a sentiment shared by most women, especially the ones that are having a baby for the first time, and the ones whose biological clock, as we say, is ticking. As beautiful as it is, it is also 9 months of worrying about, how is your baby, how her baby is doing. Is she healthy enough to actually deliver a healthy baby? And is her dietary choices good for her baby? So I believe more can be done to make this process less nervous, less to reduce the stress out of something that is supposed to be a joyful experience for women. That's why I designed Natus. And Natus is essentially a set of products designed to remove the stress, remove the stress out of something that is supposed to be the most beautiful moment of a woman or a baby's life. And the product which I have here is a set of 3 devices, sensor-based devices, designed to track the pregnancy, a woman's pregnancy over the course of 9 months. And what you have is a baby Doppler, which allows you to essentially analyze the heartbeat of a baby and tell the mom whether the baby is doing fine. There's also a speaker at the bottom that essentially plays the heartbeat just like an ultrasound to create a better bond between the baby and the mom. The second unit is a breathalyzer, which the mom blows into every morning to essentially track how she's doing and if there's any markers of diabetes or cancer in her breath. And the third one is on what I call an electronic tongue. It's essentially a small plate, with sensors that allows you to taste food for dangerous, harmful chemicals such as mercury in things like fish or any type of food that the mom isn't necessarily sure she should be eating. And I do all that because I believe the right, our best technology should be put in the hands of people who need it the most. Moms need it because they're essentially nurturing a new life. And if we can go to space, we can actually do that for them. So all these tools are connected, with your to a smartphone or a mobile device that allows you to track your pregnancy over 9 months, that allows you to share your results with your doctor. Now, this is not going to replace a doctor, and I don't envision it to do so, but it's supposed to reduce the stress between your hospital visits. Now on to education. One of the most challenging aspects of education is that it has to compete with fun, right? And this is true for kids and for adults. And I believe that as curious creatures, we never stop learning, we never stop being curious. But the process of learning can become a chore if it's repetitive and non-exciting. You just don't want to learn anymore. So, last year, I designed what I call Discover. And the idea of Discover is to essentially tap into our innate need to discover new things, but to do so in a very playful manner. What it is essentially is a sensor board and a polychromatic dice that allow you to explore the world around you. The dice has 6 different colors on each side, and each color is linked to a specific fact about the continental regions of the world. So yellow, for instance, is linked to history, blue is linked to climate, green is linked to geography, pink demographics, orange culture, and economy, and red economy. So to play the game, the user, or the person throws the dice on the board, and whichever side lands on the board is linked to a fact inside the knowledge banks of the board. For instance, here red tells you that Canada has the 11th largest economy in the world. It is also one of the global leaders of the entertainment software industry, something that most people just don't know. But it becomes a fun little game that you play. And the user is challenged again to throw the dice until he's learned something really unique about each continental region of the world. So I love that project, number one, because I believe there is something unique about experimentation. And each time you throw the dice, there's an unexpected result. And that's how design should show to solve social problems. Thank you.
Good afternoon, good evening, everyone. I want to thank you for being here. I want to thank you so much to Vilcek Foundation, Jan, Marisa, Fuang, who have worked so hard to put this together, and for the prize and everything, Glenn and the Matt staff. And also, it's a true pleasure to share this stage with Mansour and Neri. That was really inspiring. And I hope to then move into this other set of work. I'm going to show some work. I'm going to show you three projects. We'll go into them for a second, but about experimentation, about public issues. I've been beginning the talk these days, beginning to talk about the negotiation that the polis means. And polis, usually we're used to hearing that word used as the form of a city, as what the city looks like. But what I really found interesting is that the original use of the word, it also meant the processes by which the city were made, the political alliances and negotiations that led you to that form. So it's something that my work is beginning to take on. One of the more cliched ways to start a lecture on any kind of city-making urban issue these days is to say that half of the world's population lives in cities, that's going to grow, et cetera. And I think that has led many times to solutions that are big housing. We get the new cities in China and in many other places. And what I'm interested in is that the world actually no longer matters whether it's urban, rural. Those distinctions actually hardly matter. What I'm interested in is in these connections, the global connections that our economies are making, in which women in Facatativa, Colombia, picking flowers, those flowers are going to get to Brooklyn, New York, and be sold by immigrants and bought it. And what I'm interested in is understanding the entire processes that are creating this, from the war in Colombia that is forcing women to migrate to centers of economy, the labor conditions by which these women have to work with, how those flowers are going to get shipped there, and what the life of this gentleman here is. I believe that understanding cities and urbanity in this kind of way will lead to new ways of thinking about how we design them and how we react to the urban moment. So to experiment and play with some of these ideas and begin to really explore what some of these, and by the way, I've only studied architecture. I'm actually an architect. I'm just interested in these other larger issues. So right now, I actually borrow heavily from the art world and some of the work that's happening there. I borrow from the urbanism world and from everywhere that I can, and you'll see some of the kind of transdisciplinary work we do. A friend and I, when I was at school, in grad school, founded a design agency together. And it was a little bit of a plain, kind of institutional, kind of two people, but you know, a big institutional name. But what we're really after is the idea of agency. How much power do you have over the larger systems that control your life and that control your way of being? So the operative word here that we're really interested in is that idea of agency and being an agent. So like I was saying, we've been playing around with some of these ideas. And as part of this, one thing that has become really key for us is ideas of urban conflict. That in order to design the next city, we shouldn't create cities that appear always peaceful. That cities in their full kind of vibrancy accept conflict. That's what democracy does. So we're getting there into ideas of Chantal Mouffe's kind of agonisms and antagonisms in a political realm. And her idea that what we need right now is not consensus, but we need dissensus. We need to live with the idea that we're never going to agree on something and still be able to move forward. So we're finding ways to work on that. So now, having set up the stage, I'm going to show you three projects. I'm going to start in Colombia, the place where I was born, and Colombia won today, so I'm very excited. And then we're gonna move how a project in Colombia and an architectural project actually led to a new type of project here in New York City, called Who Owns Space. I'll share with you this project and how that then led to another project engaging with communities and immigrants in Queens here. So the first thing is this idea of the negotiating economies. I'm gonna show you a project that we did in Facatativa, Colombia. Facatativa is about a 1 hour drive from Bogota. And along the side of it, this is the landscape. This is what you will see as you're passing by, and the picture is accurately blurry. And what these are gigantic greenhouses, where an industrial kind of scale of flower growth happens here. This is what the city looks like. Like I mentioned before, what happens is that these large flowers really bring people from the southern sides of Colombia that have been through a lot of war. And for the big moments here in the US, Mother's Day, Valentine's Day, really hires a lot of people, and usually women. And there are specific kind of reasons for that. And then fires them once the big season ends. So what is happening in the city is that the city is beginning to grow in a way that is not prepared to. Given this context, some of the families that I'm talking about asked us if we, and by the way, Facatativa is where my family is from, so it's a place I've known since I was a child. Asked us, they knew I was an architect, 50 families had formed a co-op, and they wanted to design some housing. So we did some community engagement, began to do kind of like, almost even typical, kind of like putting out issues on the big table. We also did formal research. We were looking at that this is the way that social housing is being built in Colombia right now. So it's a kind of eight houses, two houses back to back, very narrow facades and deep kind of plans. But we were beginning to think about what we can do that at multiple levels. One of the first things, the ideas we had is to how to recreate the colonial, yet by now traditional, Spanish house into the public housing. So designing some interior cores that could serve as a way to bring utilities, natural systems, light, wind, water, and also circulation. What this would begin to do is give us an opportunity to create a third space, a space that could be shared collectively and that could be belong to entire eight houses in here. And further than that, what it allowed us is to begin to think about how to intervene in the way in which Colombia gives subsidies for public housing. So right now, let's say this is kind of old, but it's still accurate, a house for a person that's that the government is gonna help, it costs $10,000. Out of that, half of it is a government subsidy, half of it is a savings, and a quarter is savings, and a quarter is a private loan. So we were wondering how we can begin to look at that third space as a way to collectivize those loans and really begin to pull resources together for micro businesses. This is what that would look like. This entire project is on hold because of larger political processes. Some of the people no longer qualify for subsidies, but we are working with a lawyer to see how to make this happen. But one thing that I kept thinking about was those flower industries. And look at this. This is what the urban footprint is, and this is the flower industry. And we began to do a series of research, trying to understand all the things that the flower industry is doing to the periphery of Facatativa. It's poisoning the water with very concentrated amounts of fertilizers. It is hiring a specific set of people, usually displaced women, for specific reasons in a somewhat kind of machista culture. That's a reason why that would be. And we began to make a series of short videos to share our research with people. We would release them on Valentine's Day, trying to ruin people's days. Not really, but really to try to get people to understand that this rose connects us to the larger system in which we belong to. But then there was also this. Facatativa is a typical kind of Spanish city, meaning that it has a plaza or a Spanish colonial city. It has a plaza, it has church, it has city hall right in front of it, and then it's where most of life happens. What we began to notice is that because of the flower industry and this influx of people, people are beginning to live in the peripheries. And those peripheries no longer have any types of public spaces. So to the point that now the public space, if you could call it that, is the parking lots of things like Carrefours. For those that may not know, Carrefour is basically a French Walmart. So now the things that would have happened usually in a plaza or in an actual shared space now happens out in a commercialized space. So around the time when we were thinking and talking about those issues, Occupy Wall Street happened. And one of the things that to me is most interesting, and maybe it's because of my particular lens, was the fact that it happened in a privately owned public space. So we took it on as a way to test out and try to understand better the issues that we were looking at a Facatativa of a privatized city, understanding that New York and Facatativa may have more in common in the current kind of global and economic system, political and economic system, than not. And then there was this thing right here. PoPs, privately owned public spaces, are negotiations that have happened between a developer and the city, and the developer can go higher, can grow taller in return for this space that they are by law obliged to continue to maintain, but that is open to the public. That has regulations, and then all of a sudden you see rules like this. How do you enforce a rule that says no excessive use of space? Is it according to time? Is it how loud you are? All of a sudden, we begin to ask some real kind of questions of what does it mean to be in public? What does it mean to be together? This specific sign is on 66 West Wall Street, 66 Wall Street. It's an interior privately owned public space, or PoPs, which I'm going to begin to use the shorthand for. So in order to do this, we didn't want to do it by ourselves. We wanted to partner up with a group of people. So we brought urban planners, artists, and lawyers, and exhibition designers, actually, into it. At one point, we had ballerinas. We had like a whole group of people that were interested in understanding public space better. The idea was to reveal those conflicting rules and the ownerships, to question them, to advocate and propose and intervene when appropriate. The first thing we did was this. It was a map of the PoPs on one side and then the city maintained parks on another. Not actually saying that one is better than the other necessarily, but really trying to study and understand the problems with both. And given right now kind of tax situation, larger kind of political situations, all parks are hurting. Maintenance money's not there, et cetera. So on one side, we had the PoPs. And one thing that I've always liked about this map a lot is how it shows that although Occupy Wall Street happened here, most of the powerful entities that this group was trying to talk to was actually here. It's just a meditation on the symbolic in this moment in time in our society, where we no longer don't even know where power is to be able to talk to it. But saying Occupy Midtown would have meant nothing. So we even have to use a symbol to protest symbolic power, really, or not real power, but shown in symbols, because it's real power. Anyway, so these things have the rules that navigate them. These actually were plotted in 11x17s and given out at Zuccotti Park. Then the next step is, how do we go into this map so we don't leave it so elevated? And instead of trying to do like a Google map or something that is digital and issue, we decided to do tours of the three areas with the most PoPs. The Upper East Side, which actually a lot of those tall residential buildings have public space within them. But the funny thing is that most people, even the security guards and other people that work here, don't even know that's a public space. So if you go try to sit there, it'll probably kick you out. And then Midtown, which a lot of them, you probably are familiar around this area, kind of, you know, clean spaces to eat a sandwich. Same thing down here in the financial district. We did this, we went with maps, we were discussing the nature and qualities of public space. And I think that I just gave you some of the things that we found out in the financial district, actually a workshop run by Reina, who's here. They try to go into places where they couldn't, and that legally those pubs should be open, but because of 9/11, everything's closed and you can't really ask questions. Then in Midtown, what we noticed was that a lot of the spaces have become interior pubs because interior pubs have different rules than exterior pubs. And then in the Upper East Side, like I mentioned, we found the problem is that no one even knows that those are public spaces. Next. I had that as a man, but anyway. The next thing that happened is then, and again, the idea that this is a negotiation, the Sukari Park got evicted. So what we did is with a lawyer, Paula Siegel, and I began to do a series of vignettes showing the laws that were being broken by the closure of the park in the way that it was done at that time. And at the same time, asked people to flood the building department's email with complaints about that issue. And then groups like the New York Civil Liberties Union joined the call, and very soon the barriers came down. And what I really liked about this project is that it began to show me maybe design as a different way where you could begin to use design as larger engagement, as bringing people in, creating collaborations. We did something in real space, but it took many, many forms. And it took actually getting working with a lawyer. I would not have known a lot of those laws. I would not have gotten those other relationships just by myself. So it really took serious rethinking about what design meant here. But I would argue that this action was designed. So finally, this work and a lot of other things that happened through Home Space led to a project in Corona Plaza, where we were asked to engage with the community to try to understand what the plaza there should be. This was one of the plazas that's part of the New York Department of Parks plazas. One had gone in Jackson Heights around, I think, 78 and Roosevelt. That just was not very much appreciated. It just the local businesses didn't like it. It was one of the few that really was seen at the time. I think things have changed by now, but it was seen as a failure. So when they went to Corona, the Queens Museum, which was the programming partner, asked us to come and help. And what we did is, and again, here we were not interested in sitting people and asking, what do you want in the plaza? The kind of typical community engagement that puts a map in front of people and asks, where do you want your umbrellas, your chairs, your tables? What we wanted to do is really, again, talk about the conflicts, the type of things that the public space could host and talk about, but that are unusually expressed. So the first thing we did was a series of six signs that we attached to existing infrastructure. Each of the signs pointed at a specific conflict or issue. We changed the word conflict because although academically I can use it and I understand it, I don't necessarily mean that it's a bad thing and I'm not trying to solve conflict. So we changed it to boundary, so it was a little bit easier to like work around and understand. But we were asking specific questions. We were going around issues, pointing at actors that could help, and included diagrams, like complex diagrams about how the space was or was not used for certain things. So here, the blue is mostly commercial space. The yellow is most of the public kind of actual spaces there. And then some of the larger elements, both fixed and unfixed, that made up that spatial experience. We did this for six issues or boundaries, such as belonging, social services, transportation. But the idea here was not to get, again, like we want a new bike lane. What we really wanted to do with these is to talk to people, use them as excuses for conversations. And those conversations, similarly to that first kind of the two pictures that I put right next to each other, or the Who Owns Space where we drew on top the legal, is to begin to understand how the everyday experience of a person can lead to design moments. So in this case, what happened is by engaging about transportation and the type of more open-ended questions that we asked, we got people to begin to tell us about where they live, how many roommates they have, what is the spatial relationship of their house to the street, how do they get to Corona Plus, and then how do they get to work? What does it mean for them as a single man, mostly Latino men that we were talking to in that area, to use public space, et cetera. So it became ways to have complex conversations about issues such as stop and frisk, the immigrant experience, housing, and honestly, the anxiety that everyone has all over the city about displacement. We did this again. So the things that we learned there, and now beginning to think about how to engage and begin to use this to design things, created a game. And these were the pieces. There were 15 pieces for 5 issues. Again, community programming, local economies, mobility, green spaces, and social services. And we created 15 pieces made out of kind of found materials. But only 12 could be used at a time and through certain prompts. So the idea was here to really begin to have conversations about what does it mean to have a local economy? So one of the big anxieties that came up is that people were afraid that there will no longer be space in the plaza as it got nicer, as that whole area got nicer, for the woman that sits in the corner and sells tamales. That some of those anxieties. Obviously, this is an ongoing project, it hasn't ended yet, so what we're going to take is those stories and those type of things that we learn and begin to produce designs that that respond to those stories. Again, we're not trying to solve because these are issues that may or may not have a resolution, but we want to put a design element into the world to see how that design element plays within those conflicts and what it can do. We're doing this by, I'm writing a book right now on Corona, going on this, designing certain pieces of it. But one way that we did, that one thing that I've done since the Corona project is I designed this for Medellin, Colombia, for the World Urban Forum. This was a booth design in which a lot of the elements were inspired by some of the research we did in Corona. So everything has 2, 3, 4 different uses. So for example, here, these larger kind of cube structures hold the seating and the actual presentation, the exhibit. The benches become bookshelves and become blackboards. The panels in which the information, the official information, is supposed to be meant to be on, is they're turned into tables and ways in which people can give us feedback instead. So this idea of having these pieces that are movable, that are urban, that this was the problem here was how to design a booth that didn't look corporate, that wasn't trying to tell you something, but really asked you to engage with it and have a conversation. This was done for the Housing and Urban Development through Next City and the Ford Foundation, a whole bunch of people. And it tried to be critical even of those process institutions. And so these are some of the things that we have learned through the projects. We are now we are beginning to move into housing again. So we started with housing in Colombia. We moved into this world to try to really understand the tropes that architecture and urbanism sometimes use. Like, we throw the word around public way too easily. Now I want to go back into housing because, again, the anxiety that you see all over the cities that we all might get displaced at one point. So we're doing the research right now into collectivity in housing, how community land trusts, how co-ops, how different ways of sharing resources have worked here in the U.S., in New York specifically, because there are many examples here, especially actually among immigrant communities. I don't know if someone just published in the Asian American Writers Workshop an article on Finnish co-ops in Sunset Park and Bay Ridge. And it's fascinating to see how like those co-ops really worked. And I think as they put it, it's part kind of leftist utopia, part Portlandia, everyone making pickles. But those type of things are really beginning to become more important as we need to figure out ways to create new housing. Thank you.
I wanted to start and end with a single statement about the world of design at large. This includes fashion design, product design, architectural design, avionic design, automobile design, and of course, cities design. And to claim that the world of design as we know it has been subjugated to the rules and legislations of mass production and mass manufacturing. So assembly lines have brought a culture that limits and frames the imagination of designers who like to think or who think about their designs as an assembly of discrete parts that are put together, like this Volkswagen car. How many parts are in this image and how many parts make a car? Any ideas? About 10,000. Any other ideas? So this was close. This is 14,000 parts to create a car. And how many parts to create a silkworm cocoon? Anyone? One, yes, exactly. So the silkworm spins a single fiber, a single filament of silk, and varies its properties as it forms this highly, highly complex house for its metamorphosis. And so we're interested in that kind of disposition between how we make things and how nature makes things. And we try to bring some of those understandings and principles that we find in nature into the design of the artificial. How many parts in a carpal tunnel splint glove? There are three parts here. And the glove is made of course, the fabric that provides for the comfort, the splint, the aluminum splint that constrains the mobility and the movement of the hand at the wrist, and the circulation beads at the root of the hand that enhance the circulation. But what if we could 3D print this glove out of a single material, and this single material would vary its properties. It would vary its material properties spatially. It would distribute harder materials where you need them and softer materials where you need those. And then those materials would also change in time as a function of whatever the activity it is that you're doing, whether you're sleeping, typing, or rock climbing. So a single technical slide to sort of get you all on board to learn more about the work that we do in my group. So this is the process, minus the animation that's not working, I apologize, in the third slide. But we start with a phenomenon that we find in the natural or biological world. And that phenomenon like this, and this again should be an animation, is usually a six or more dimensional space. It is a multi-dimensional space. In this case, you're looking at an image that describes a mathematical model called reaction diffusion that explains what happens when, that is a blood clotting model that explains what happens when you mix oil and water together, that also provides explanation what happens when we expose our skins to the sun for the creation of pigments. And so these spaces are usually made up of more than three dimensions, X, Y, Z, in this case, oil, water, and temperature. Then there is the two-dimensional space, which is, in the case of the glove that you've seen in the previous slide, is simply an unfolded version of the glove. So you're taking the three-dimensional product, you're unfolding it into its two dimensions, and you're projecting the biological phenomenon on top of the object space. And then you end up with a three-dimensional object that has that kind of aspect of multi-property and multiple variations, a little bit like the human skin. So we're interested in creating products without parts and processes without partitions. And we do so by working with and also inventing our own technologies that support multifunctionality. The human skin is made of thin skin in our faces, very large pores, thick skins in our back, very small pores. Here it acts as a filter, here as a barrier. Can we design systems that combine these multifunctionalities, that combine these functionalities in a single system, and how to do that? So we sit in the middle of this sphere at the cross section of digital fabrication, material science, and computer science. And we do work across all scales, from architectural to product design. And I'm going to demonstrate a few ideas, perhaps starting in 2012 with an exhibition we did at the Centre Pompidou in Paris that was inspired by the Book of Imaginary Beings, a book by Jorge Luis Borges that was written in 1957. And mythologies really are metaphors to understand human augmentation, right? So Daedalus designs the wings of Icarus as a means for Icarus to escape Crete. Icarus flies into the sun. He is tempted by the sun. This is also the story of the limit of human ambition. The feathers disintegrate, the wax melts. So the myth that we know so well, that is described in words and stories, is actually very much a story about materials. And it is very much a story about design. In fact, it may well be the first design project known to mankind. The same goes for the myth of Prometheus, right? So Prometheus stole the fire from Zeus and was condemned to have his liver devoured by the great eagle every day, only to discover that his liver can regrow. But how did the Greeks know thousands of years ago that the liver is the only human organ, except for the skin, that can regenerate itself? So in many ways, myths are also tell the stories and project scientific discoveries. This is sort of Jan and Maritza. So how to actually design for multifunctionality? We designed 18 objects for the show, and we used a new technology developed by Stratasys using the Conex 500 for the 3D printing savvy designers in the room. But what this technology allows us to do is basically print in very, very high resolution. And that allows us to enter what can't be seen in the physical world. When we design a bathing suit, we can't see really the movement of the water against the skin and how to enter that resolution and make it powerful, functional, efficient for the design of a swimsuit or a car or a building. This is a helmet. It's called Minotaur Head. It's made of two materials, black and white. The black is stiff, the white is soft. But you'll see it's very difficult to determine where the hard material ends and where the soft material begins. Why? Because we've developed this technique, the bitmap printing process with Stratasys, to be able to print in 16 micron resolution. So in today's products, we're not able yet to reach that kind of resolution that would allow us in the future, for example, to take that helmet and model it around a CT scan. So you would come in as a patient, your head would be CT scanned, and the data, the voxelized, pixelized data, would be fed to the printer that would assign soft materials to hard tissue, hard materials to soft tissue. So you could inversely map those properties according to the variation of properties of the physical tissue. Again, highly, highly customized process, and also a process that uses a single procedure. And here again, you see that kind of high resolution. I'm going to quickly go through the various projects. This is Gravida, a pregnancy corset. Again, pregnancy is fashionable today. So the outer part is a stiff shell. The inner part is a soft fabric that stretches with the woman's body. Again, one process, two materials, multifunctionality, protection plus comfort. Medusa is another helmet that looks at protection and flexibility, and Arachne, an armor. Leviathan, another armor that promotes rotational movement while also providing for protection. And finally, the dress that we designed with Iris van Herpen for her show, together with Professor Craig Carter and Karen Oxman, a dress that's made of two parts, a cape and a skirt, that's printed of those elements that vary in their material property, in their geometry. So they vary in shape, size, direction, length, and the properties themselves. The black material is soft, the white material is stiff. And again, printing those fabric pieces in a single process without seams. there may be a video. No, just a heavy image. So another image of cape and skirt. This is the most recent project that we've done with Stratasys, and the first one also to be designed with their new technology, the Conix 3, looking at the variation of rigidity, opacity, and color. It is a design for a reclining chair that's made of 44 different materials that vary in those properties. And it was a combination between more traditional fabrication, CNC milling of the wooden piece that's connected with a three-dimensional printed skin that is very comfortable, I can say, but also supports for absorbing sound. So it was designed as an acoustical chaise to guard or offer a quieting environment for the human mind. So last but not least, I wanted to touch upon biology. Up until now, you've seen projects that look at additive manufacturing from the perspective, or look at nature from the perspective of algorithms, and look at how to derive certain algorithms from nature and apply them to the design of products. But we're not actually using nature to design them. In addition, so this project really looks at how to use or how to make friends with nature to build things together in symbiosis. But this coming project is also questioning the role of additive manufacturing in design. We know that a 3D printer has three main limitations: the material limitation, materials are not structural enough; the gantry limitation, you can always only print something that's smaller than the size of the tray, the size of the gantry. And the process limitation, printing is about printing layers one on top of the other, but we know that nature doesn't print, right? Nature grows, it spins, and there are other processes to explore. So we started looking at the silkworm, because to us, the silkworm represented the transcendence of those three limitations. It spins its housing out of silk, which is one of the most structural, supreme materials known to us. It does print, quote unquote print, spin a structure that is bigger than its body. And it also does not print the structure, it spins it in a highly complex three-dimensional movement. And so with that in mind, we looked at motion capturing the movement of the silkworm in space to try to understand this complex behavior, and ended up designing a full-scale architectural pavilion made out of silk that was constructed using a robotic fabrication technology and the help of 6,500 silkworms. Let me just wrap up by telling you how this was done. We started by investigating the properties of silk. Silk varies its properties, its structural, material, environmental properties. It's made of two chemical components, sericin and fibrin, fibers and matrix, like anything in nature. And those provide for the structural habitat of the silkworm as it metamorphosizes, but they also provide for the immune system of the cocoon. And so again, multifunctionality and various variable properties. We then started exploring how it goes about spinning its cocoon, and we've discovered that if we would if we were to design a flat patch, the silkworm would go about spinning a unfolded cocoon, a flat cocoon. It always looks for the corner of a table or the branch of a tree for a vertical axis in order for it to successfully spin a three-dimensional cocoon. The key dimension was 21 millimeters. Once this prong that you saw in the center was above 21 millimeters, we got a cocoon. As long as it was below 21 millimeters, we got a tent structure, a relatively flat structure. And that's when we understood that, we started varying the properties of of these environments to generate different kind of configurations for spinning. So we could predict the spinning behavior depending on those designed environments or templated environments on which the silkworm spun its cocoon. And these became very interesting to us because we thought, wow, now we can actually use nature to compute with us and for us. And so we've been using those as finite element analysis calculations. And I can talk more about this for those who are interested. We superglued a tiny earth magnet to the head of the silkworm. You see it right here. This was a single silkworm that was placed inside a rig with magneto sensors in order to motion track its movement. On the right, you see a 1 million point cloud that depicts this highly complex movement of the silkworm in space. And then we use the same exact process that you saw in the first technical slide for the design of this project. The form of the structure from the top is a dome. The dome was placed inside the MIT Media Lab such that the south and east elevation brought light into the space. Now, we knew that silkworms prefer darker areas and colder areas, and therefore, we knew that most of the silkworms, once deployed, will migrate to this area of the pavilion. And therefore, we had to build more silk to support the structure structurally using our robotic technology. And so this was the first attempt at the algorithm that was designed only to generate the first primary structure on top of which the silkworms were then deployed. You can see various holes or apertures inside the structure. The apertures vary in size, vary in diameter as a function of the light. Their role is to capture the light rays that are coming into the structure and to allow the light and the heat to then guide the movement of the silkworms. For some reason, this is the unfolded 26 polygonal patches that were unfolded. This is how we actually structured, actually fabricated the pavilion out of the unfolded configuration. These are two patches that vary. You see how they're varying in density. This is the final tool that allowed us to spin the primary structure, again, out of silk, and the secondary structure was the biological structure. So I have a 90-second video that describes the process. Here you see the red as indicating the south and east elevation. Here you see the computational algorithm that was devised to build the primary structure. So silk spun using a shot pot. These are the 6,500 silkworms that were ordered online. They were placed at the ream of the pavilion quite loosely. And the beautiful thing about this project is that they were allowed to metamorphosize throughout the project rather than be killed by boiling as they are in the silk industry. So this is the Bombay Mori, the domesticated silk moth. As they spin on top of the pavilion, they lay eggs, they mate. We have about 150 million eggs, so we can build various more pavilions using those eggs. And again, they go through the entire metamorphosis stage about 10 days of spinning. This was a first project that looks into the symbiosis between man-made robotic digital fabrication and biological fabrication. And for anyone of you who visits the Media Lab, please come and see us. Thank you so much.
So I hope you'll agree with me that three fantastic presentations and amazing bodies of work and very varied as well. So everything from personal technology that Mansour was investigating to the politically engaged activist and public spaces that Quilian is investigating, and then the mind-blowing cooperative technologies of worms and machines and people, sort of more than six-dimensional collaborations that Neri and her team at MIT are engaging with. I thought I would take a step back, given the theme of the evening and the sponsorship of the Vilcek Foundation, and bring us all together to think about the fact of immigration, first of all, and to ask you not so much about your own personal experiences necessarily, but perhaps if you could reflect on the global dimensions of design and the way that immigration interfaces with the design sphere. I wonder whether each of you in turn could reflect on, for example, the role that cross-national, cross-continental movement has had, not only in your own careers and but in terms of your experiences of design as a whole. It seems to me that we are, in fact, a much more networked culture now, and that, of course, happens not only through our interactivity across computer digital networks, but in fact, according to the movement of bodies in space. So I wonder if each of you could talk a little bit about what immigration means to you in relation to design practice. Quilian, would you like to start?
Sure. So there's a lot of things there, so I'm going to try to see how I can do this. But about immigration, I think that a lot of the things that I'm going to do it by my own personal stories. I moved here from Colombia. I moved to Miami, to Hialeah, actually to an area that was a little bit kind of, if anyone knows Hialeah, it's kind of like the Latino area of Miami. I mean, kind of all of Miami is, but even more than other parts. But a lot of the spaces were empty. You needed a car to get anywhere. So all of a sudden, kind of like my memory of Colombia, and Bogota has changed dramatically since then to actually look a lot more like Miami, meaning malls everywhere, you need a car to get anywhere. But I remember the maybe a little bit of the other thing, which was life on the street, plazas, you could talk to people, there was always somewhat a lot of vibrant, not vibrancy just in people there shopping, but also discourse and conversations. And so I think that for me personally, that kind of immigration story kind of really has led me to what I'm doing now. But besides that, also these ideas of change, that immigration and what immigrants do in many cases is bring changes to whatever it is. Many times when we talk about immigration, there's something coming to change the other. And I find those, even those ideas, I'm beginning to think about it abstractly like that, that it's helpful to think about the American city today, that it has to be designed for change. I mean, that it has to be designed, maybe to put it in a silly way, but in a funny way, like with Neri's beautiful two materials, one that responds and one that is permanent, that it allows that flexibility that was quite beautiful to see there. And then for the global, I wonder if it is changing the global kind of conversation. I hope it is. I guess maybe we are. So the thing is that, for example, you go to schools now, and over half of the student body is from other places. Not all of them are immigrants. Some are probably future immigrants. But it really, there's a sense that the future is going to be, like you're saying, these cross-cultural conversations, and maybe immigrants are ready for them, because we are always going to be somewhat cross-cultural, never belonging to either side.
Yeah, big question. I think I have a mic here. Is this mic working? Hello?
Yes, okay.
Migration. I think there are many things that we can say about migration. I think in general, it's always been, it always will be. It will never change. In a way, civilization cannot grow without migration, right? It is a form of pollination. I think what perhaps has changed since the time of prior to the digital age, and I'm thinking the Silk Road, right? In a way, the Silk Road itself was a form of migration. In that migration, a whole civilization was formed. But I think what's so special about today's age is that we're sort of transcending migration in space, in spatial dimensions, into migrations that don't require physical movement from one location to another, but migrations that are about the migrations of the immaterial. And so because of social networks and because of Twitter and other various GPS-based technologies, we can now communicate across space, but also across time. I have a friend who's saying he's tweeting for his grandchildren, and so that they'll get to know him through his tweets. And so there's also migration across generations, and I think that kind of age of digital, the kind of digital swarm is augmenting migration that is beyond a spatial and a physical one.
Hello? Okay. So, immigration. I think when it comes to design, at least physical design, product design, I think what immigration does best is to expose all of us to ideas we wouldn't necessarily think about. And that's within the context of design, for instance. I remember when I went to Sweden and I met a bunch of people from Turkey and New Zealand and, you know, all over the place with different ideas about design. We're all in the same school, but, you know, you could tell we had different experiences, but it didn't diminish, you know, how good we were as designers. And one of the things I enjoyed about moving to the US when I was 16 was the fact that the US doesn't have this homogeneous design culture, right? I mean, in Sweden, you know, there's a Bauhaus and, you know, there's a Scandinavian design, which is obvious sometimes. And I think the US sort of enjoys this diversity in ideas because we all come from different places. We all bring ideas from different places, but we're allowed to sort of blend it, you know, in one location. Sometimes it's ugly, but, you know, but at least we bring in personalities that at the end of the day make it a sort of beautiful mosaic of, you know, I would say of what the world really looks like. I think that, I mean, yeah, that's what it means to me.
Passing of the mic. I wanted to ask another question. Maybe we could actually begin with you, Mansour, about familiarity versus unfamiliarity in design. And I'm thinking particularly here of visual or aesthetic familiarity. And what prompted this to my mind was actually your designs for the condition of pregnancy, which clearly talk to the visual language of the iPhone. And it's striking to me that you're using that as a pathway into a kind of comfort level for the user. And I was wondering what each of your thoughts were on the strategic use of visual familiarity, or indeed a kind of alienness. For example, Neri, in your almost science fiction looking armors. And then obviously for you, Quilian, the whole question of communication within a local community and speaking to people in a way that perhaps does not seem interruptive as a way to produce interruption. So talking in a familiar way to produce a condition of novelty or change seems to be a very important dynamic. So I wonder if each of you could talk a little bit about that just as a design strategist.
I guess, you know, I'll start with a short story. I remember when I first started design, you know, I was sort of amazed that we actually got paid to do this, right? because when you think of within the grand scheme of things, you sort of wonder, what exactly are we doing, right? Are we making anything relevant, or, you know, can't robots do this job? You know, will we be extinct once robots get smart and can draw pictures better than we do? But I think what I've come to realize is that there's an emotional aspect of design, which is the reason why we are still employed. You know, there's a part of it that is very much human. And that's the part that, as designers, we are sort of, you know, taught to tap into. So when it comes to familiarity, like you said, right, there's a sort of resemblance here to what's going on, you know, in the trends today, you know, the sort of iPhone-like type of design. So when I was working on this, my thinking was, you know, most of the tools we design for pregnancy, a sort of medical, you know, tells you, hey, there's danger, right? There's something wrong with you. You know, you have a baby, it's a beautiful thing, but everything around just feels like you're ready to die. And, you know, I mean, the machines don't look any different than someone who is going to the ER for an operation. And that's why we get employers, is for us to sort of pinpoint those things. You know, there's a difference between someone having a baby and someone, you know, needing a new heart, for instance. And what I wanted to do with these tools is that, is to create a device or create a system of products that tells you that this is a beautiful thing, that tells you that, you know, someone cared about what's going on with you enough to put enough thought into the design, to put enough thought into it, to make it familiar enough for you and make it comfortable enough for you that you can actually put it on your body and, you know, have it figure out what's going on with your pregnancy.
I'll ask you for the exact curvature of the device. It's true. There's a kind of a design language that evolves in time that's very much inherent to the type of tools and technologies that that are out there for our disposals, designers and makers and engineers, that defines exactly the circumference of a spherical form or the location of a screw. And yes, these come from technologies, hence the first automobile Volkswagen 14,000 part image, that we still make things in that way, and we will likely do so for a while. And so that relationship, I would say that notion of familiarity begins with the origin of these forms, not the forms themselves, but what actually makes those forms and what technologies are available for the creation and fabrication of these forms. I think, like Mansour, I think design is a form of storytelling, but it also comes with social responsibility. And so I think those two components, storytelling and a responsibility, form something that is not only familiar to the eye, but familiar to the mind, you know, that warns or that embraces. And so there are a lot of components that have to come together. Personally, I love fantasy and the forms of nature, and of course I try to bring those into our designs, but also the technologies that actually create those forms, speak the language of their expression.
This is a really interesting question, because especially as an architect, a lot of the tools that we use sometimes are impenetrable to a lot of people that don't study architecture. It's almost like even, you know, a lot of professions have jargon, but even our drawings, many times the way we work has that quality, even though at the end result is has to be accessible. I mean, you experience it. For one thing that I've always struggled with is how to use the familiar and unfamiliar, because you're right. For example, the designs that we design were done in perspective for a specific reason, because people usually understand perspective. One kind of truism almost is that in any conversation, if you're an architect and you want your client to understand your project, or if you're engaging a community, do a perspective or a model. Everything else just will kind of go, it's just impenetrable. Yet there's a lot of power in the other tools, such as kind of plans, sections, some of the other axles. I'm a big fan of axonometric, just because it begins to show you kind of social relationships in space, and many times in ways that other things can't. So we have taken it both as how do we use kind of some of the things that might make things more familiar, such as you're not even looking at a diagram anymore, you're looking at the thing that you have observed always, the design, but now it gives it a slightly new thing, and it begins to make it accessible while not dumbing it down. Because quite honestly, sometimes when involved in the kind of work I do, which in the art world is called social practice, it's beginning to be done by a lot of people, but beginning to be called, sometimes there's a shyness about using the tools. It was just in Chicago, and in there, there was a discussion whether or not we should use a plan, because we're working in this big housing complex, public housing complex called Lathrop. And most of it is empty right now. The future of it, it's unknown, and right now it's... And I think that that could be helping people. And so what I did is, instead of having a very intimidating map or plan, I began to put it in tape, made it out of painter's tape on a big wall, and began to make it a little bit more familiar, and began to really, and in a way, almost share the tools that I have, so that when I leave, the people that I stay, and is a group that involves artists, and it can stay behind. And in that same project, actually, I got to see, I don't know if you are familiar with some of the Astor Gates' work, one of the people that worked with him is John Preuss. And John Preuss was one of the people that we were doing the workshop with together. And he did this gigantic thing called the Beast. And outside of it looks like a gigantic bull, and you walk inside of it, and that's where some of the lectures and workshops are happening. And it's this crazy kind of almost biological thing of a new type of structure. It reminded me of like a Bucky Fuller structure that all of a sudden someone had gone a little bit kind of, they didn't want that perfection. They wanted a part to be stronger than the other. But what I liked about it is that in a cohesive kind of aesthetic, the outside it looked like a bull, but inside it was just kind of insanity. What it created is still unfamiliar. And what it made me meditate on is how the unfamiliar is helpful in a political arena, because you begin to have conversations you usually don't. So it created the stage for unfamiliar conversations.
If I could just ask one last question, then we'll turn it open to the audience. I wanted to ask you each about the concept of the prototype. And the reason I ask this question is because it's a topic of particular interest to me as a design historian with a particular interest in making practices. Because as we know, craft has this reputation of being a traditional thing that is static and rooted in the past. But one thing that I have found very striking in talking to designers is that the interface where the present meets the future, in other words, where the innovation happens, is often in the moment of making the prototype, which is almost entirely handmade as a genre of object. Almost every design prototype is made by a skilled artisan of some type or another. So that's one reason I'm interested in prototyping, because it's one example of how skilled making affects the world around us in ways that we don't necessarily detect. You know, that one handmade object may be replicated 100,000 times and fill the environment around us, which places a great deal of pressure on that object. But in addition to this, and perhaps what I was more interested to hear from you all, is the question of what a prototype what effect a prototype has on the culture around it merely by its own existence. Because I find it striking that each of you consistently produce prototypes that do not find a future in serial production. There may be only one propositional or even provocative object that is not necessarily serially or mass-produced. And in fact, Neri, you had suggested that there was perhaps some corrective agenda in relation to mass production, which your practice might offer, which seems to be to have something to do with the traditional concept of the prototype. So I thought we might start with you to ask you about that question.
I wanted to answer and say that there is no prototype. And then I would just end my my comment. We can talk about the prototype as scholars, or we can just plainly admit that prototyping is how we work. Prototyping is a mirror of the thoughts and the actions that come together in the design of an object. And David's Michelangelo's David was made out of a single block of marble. There were no prototypes for the full-scale sculpture. In fact, I think the marble was laid out in the environment open to the elements for 25 years before Michelangelo was commissioned. Prototyping is definitely a form of thinking through, a form of creating representations that test your hypothesis as a designer, physical and material ones, but I think also they are prototypes of thinking. I think prototypes also offer that possibility of looking at your approach and sort of testing it. And in that sense, the prototype is not the object of desire. In fact, it is the approach or the thinking process or the method that is the object of desire. It's not the product, it's the process that is prototyped. And this is true also for evolution, right? So biological evolution occurs through processes that are prototyped. So to me, prototyping very, very much encompasses that kind of domain, that kind of space that is, again, not necessarily a material space. All the models that I've shown that we've made for the Pompidou exhibit were prototypes that were the final object. We, in fact, had only one single try at them. Many of those models took 120, roughly, hours to print, so several days with the hope that there would be no, that the electricity would keep on going, and every time we lost electricity, we lost I don't know how many hours of print that were, of course, very costly. And so we designed those objects in the digital realm with a lot of the kind of craft, I would say, that one invests in a physical prototype, but also with a lot of faith that they would come out and be the product itself. Yep. Mansour.
I think we are, you know, at sort of a crossroad, you know, because we have a very strong digital, you know, I don't want to say world, but sort of a digital culture, and at the same time, there's this physical, you know, representation of it, which a lot of times the lines get blurred, right? Because digital tools are so powerful now, it is, you know, I mean, we have problems with, you know, models not looking like they truly look, right? Because someone can just Photoshop the hell out of it and make them as beautiful as they want, you know? And there are new breeds of artists who can do amazing things in the digital realm. But the flip side of that is that it sort of distorts people's idea of what a product is, right? There's a difference between a car looking amazing, you know, on a sunset in a picture, and you actually seeing that car in your garage. Right, and then you go, well, it doesn't look like the poster. And I think that's what prototypes are like for us as designers, is that we've reached a point, I would say about, 5 years ago, we reached a point where everything was done digitally, and then you go from digital to let's produce this, because China was a boom, and you could just make things as fast as possible. And people started to understand that the final result didn't look as good as the picture. And that's where the problem, you know, the problem began. And I think right now people are going back to the idea of testing things out before you tell people that this actually works, you know, because it's someone's livelihood, it's someone's money, and, you know, you don't want to cheat them out of it. But what a prototype does for a designer is that it allows you to make mistakes, right? It allows you to make a million mistakes before you find the right answer. And I made about 10 prototypes of this thing before I got to this point where every curve and every line and, you know, every detail was exactly what I wanted. And most times, like I said, most times you sort of tweak things out in the digital realm because you want it to look that good, but you realize it's either too big or too small. It's not really, you know, it's not really that orange, or it's not really that white. And it's when you, and I, for me, the joy is seeing this in a package and going, wow, I made this. I started from zero, I started from a blank sheet of paper, you know, and one stupid idea, and now it exists, you know. And I think it goes back to what it means to be human, is that we just, we make things, and, you know, we like seeing things happen, and, you know, not just dream them and just go home, you know. So.
I you know, I'm going to look at the issue of prototyping as two slightly different things, because since my work is not always object-based, we're trying to get at different things. One is that, yeah, for some of the things, I actually love prototyping. I love kind of trying to figure out the craft. The signs, for example, took a while because we had to go and get the perspectives right. We had to go back and test that it would work. We had to go back and begin to think about where... what height are most of the people in this neighborhood, and how would they be looking? What would it be like? How could we make this something actually that works? So we that those signs ended up taking a few weeks of experimentation, of thinking about sidelines, thinking about what does it mean to create what people in the community began to call it, which was lo-fi augmented reality that begins to, those things could begin to form a few future kind of moments in which you wonder what you can do with that tool in the future. And I want to deploy it again also to begin to have potential futures or some of these things more interactive even. So the second thing is not so much about prototyping, but it's about research in action, because a lot of the work that I've been doing, a lot of what you saw today, is engaging design as a tool to create research around certain issues. Meaning that very little of it, and again, ended up in an object. But what we have decided is that our research needs to be include others, and it really needs to be a little more cohesive. So our prototype, in many cases, can be seen a little bit as reenactments or enactments of embodiments of some of the processes or negotiations that would be required to create some of these public spaces. So the engagement itself begins to create some of those, so that when the spaces appear, maybe we are already used to working or thinking about public space in certain ways. Not that there's any one solution that we're going after, we need to use this way, but that there's the conversation and that can continue to happen.
Okay, well, that is an unimprovable segue to opening the questions to the audience. So in the spirit of including others, does anybody have a question? Yes. Try the mic. Yeah, hopefully it will work. Yeah, great.
Did anybody count to make sure there were 6,500 silkworms or weigh them?
That's the internet.
The internet found out for us.
Yeah, but when you got them, nobody counted or weighed them.
We counted them, of course. We counted them. We boxed them. Yes, they were well nourished and well counted. 6,500 silkworms actually translates to 6,500 kilometers, roughly 1 kilometer for each silk cocoon. Which, in hindsight, I was looking for a number to describe what it actually meant, 6,500 kilometers, and it was the length of the Silk Road. Which is interesting.
I also have to wonder what Buckminster Fuller would have thought.
We modeled it after the Bucky Dome and the Boulay Dome, of course. Before that, the dome is this kind of ideal structure that's highly componentized in Bucky's age and biologically constructed in the new age.
I think he would have been proud.
I hope so.
Other questions for our panel? Yes.
Not really a question, but... Nobody else is asking questions. Okay. Okay, I need something to make me taller, please. Well, I would like to first thank everybody, Vilcek Foundation and the designers, and you, our dear moderator. I'm sorry, I missed the beginning. I was a little lost roaming around Columbus Circle, but I am in awe of the intelligence displayed here, and I'm very happy to see that design and architecture can lead to such multidisciplinary and also very sustainable approaches. And I really, you know, I'm seeing the future and at the same time a little bit the past, because in Quilian's work, it brought me back to my professor 35 years ago in architecture school, who made us work out a room in, for example, industrial or whatever, using the activities that were going on in this room. And Quilian is taking it to a whole new level, viewing that he is going
to the city and the urban community. So thank you very much, and really I'm in awe and inspired and a little complex now.
Thank you very much. Well, unless there's another burning question, I'm extremely tempted to leave it there with that eloquent comment. Are there any last questions? Yes, great, okay.
Yes, I'm actually just a little curious to what end do you see the dome heading, like towards what future possibilities or probabilities do you see it existing, you know, as a habitation for people or for things, storage, you know, like towards what future possible uses?
In terms of function?
Sure.
Because I thought in terms of technology, and then I wanted to say grow things. We want to grow them. We want to grow a dome. So I'll just answer what I think the question is about, and then you can give me feedback. But I'm hoping, I mean, you've seen two translations of moving from nature or from biology to design. The first one uses algorithms to translate certain processes that one finds in the natural world, and then to deploy these algorithms using digital technologies. So the translation occurs on the level of the algorithm, on the level of the logic, not on the level of the material. The second level, or the second phase of this evolution, is the use of actually natural materials. This is where material ecology comes in. I haven't had yet a chance to be explicit about that, but actually using materials made by nature, for nature, like the silk, and use those materials to create objects with them. So in the future, we'll be moving from an age of plastics to an age of other materials. Shrilk is one example for those who are curious, and I know you're curious. Shrilk is a composite that was developed at the Wyss Institute at Harvard. It's a composite that mixes shrimp and silk, hence its name. So the use of these innovative materials that are sometimes biodegradable, sometimes biocompatible in medical device design, especially, but also potentially in architecture, will make our environment much more sustainable. This is the second phase. The third phase is alluring, is exciting as much as it is frightening, and that is the age of synthetic biology. And that is the age where designers start not only using or designing with biology, but actually designing biology itself. So instead of using a computational code, you would use a DNA code, and you would sequence the DNA yourself to design a certain functional behavior. You would have walls that breathe through osmosis instead of opening, closing a window. Those walls would open and close their pores by way of ventilating the space, and of course would reduce the need for AC. And AV systems. And so I think that's where we're going in mediated matter, so moving from modeling to the use of materials to the use of biology itself as a form of computation. And that would, of course, suggest new functional uses, not that we would change the future of housing. I think I agree with Mansour at the end. The human condition has always been about something that's bigger and larger than ourselves. We will always need habitats, and we will always love cities. But I think the modes of expression and the functionalities that are combined in those highly efficient, highly effective material systems will bring us hopefully to a more healthier age where we can actually host 9 billion people on the planet without sending people to Mars, although I did hear that $70 only to take a flight to Mars, as long as you end up staying there.
Okay, I think we better leave it there. I hope that rather than continue the conversation extraterrestrially, I hope that at a minimum you will have been persuaded that you should spend the rest of your evening reflecting on where the flowers on your restaurant table came from, wondering where you can get a suit in shrilk, and of course, eating roasted grasshoppers. But in all seriousness, I think this has been an extremely mind-expanding conversation. And it strikes me that although we speak a lot about encouraging diversity in the field of culture, it's very rare to see a foundation like the Vilcek Foundation really stepping in and bringing true intellectual diversity into being. And I can't imagine a more intellectually diverse conversation than the one we've had tonight. And I think also a conversation that really attests to the ongoing value of design and knowledgeable making in the 21st century, principles that I think our panelists have exemplified beautifully tonight. So thank you to the Vilcek Foundation for bringing us together. And. Thank you, as always. At the Museum of Arts and Design, we try to recognize everybody on the team that physically makes events happen. So thank you to Kevin, our AV technologist, and Jake, our head of public programs, and the camera people and everybody else that helped us be here tonight. And of course, finally, and very much not least, thank you very much to our wonderful panelists.